Coming soon, an innovative, exciting, spirit-filled worship experience for the whole family. Carter Metropolitan Christian Methodist Episcopal Church invites you to our Family and Friends Day on Sunday, September 20th, 2020 at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can join us for anointed praise and worship, prophetic preaching, and fired up fellowship. Our special guest preacher will be the 58th Bishop of the CME Church, the presiding prelate of the 3rd Episcopal District, Bishop Sylvester Williams Sr. Save the date and we'll save you a seat. Come on and be our guest.
This morning, When we finally do get there, we're going to begin with chapter 2. Hold on to it. We'll get there in a minute. Y'all, I'm going to tell you, I want to start off. This is going to seem real strange. But there's a point to make today. One of my favorite commercials right now, and you have to understand, commercials are a passion of mine. When I was a baby, I would cry through the movie, I would cry through the news, and when a commercial would come on, I would just immediately fixate on the commercial. I've always had this thing with commercials. And so one of my favorite commercials right now is the one from Progressive. It features my girl Flo. And for those of you who don't know who Flo is, she is the very spunky and passionate insurance agent from Progressive. And so my favorite commercial is kind of set in the style of a 90s TV sitcom. Y'all, I see some of you shaking your heads. You know what I'm talking about. So they show Flo in the house doing things around the house. And then the hook comes up with the song saying, she's not the maid they wanted. But she's the maid they got. Y'all, I think that thing takes me out every time I see it. So they come in with the song, she's not the maid they want. And then Flo says, I'm not the maid! That thing tears me up. Because Flo is positioned in the home to talk about homeowners insurance. But the people misunderstood her purpose and her position. I promise you I'm going somewhere with this. So a couple of months ago, I had to fly to Milwaukee. And as I was about to go through the TSA, I just glanced down at my boarding pass. And I've seen boarding passes before. I know my flight number is going to be on my boarding pass. I know my gate is going to be on my boarding pass. And so, and the boarding pass also told me that I was in the A group to board the plane. But my position was number 30. My position was my placement. It was where I would stand with respect to everybody else who was going to board with me. My position allowed some folks to go before me. My position allowed some folks to go after me. My position could have been altered if I paid more money. Or my position could have been altered if I had booked my flight sooner. My position really could have been altered had I shown up late. I'm going somewhere. My boarding pass guaranteed me a seat on the vehicle that would take me higher and get me to the next level. But my position determined the timing of my access to my seat. Y'all still here? So when I realized that I was in a good position, I stopped worrying about how long it was going to take me to get through the TSA. When I realized that I was in a good position, I didn't worry about how far away the gate was. Because of my position, I could simply show up and take my place. Position can be a placement, position can be a title, or position can be an understanding. The right position can get me to the right place. It can get me to the next level. The right position can ensure that I have a say in what happens next. If I use my position properly, if I operate in my position with the authority and power that God has given to me, there is breakthrough and blessing for me. But on the other side of that, if I operate in my position, if I'm a good steward of my position, then my position can become a target for opposition. Oh, y'all listening now. Position and opposition. Position and opposition. A tug of war back and forth. See, it all started with Lucifer, who was cast out of heaven because of his opposition to God. Watch this. Lucifer wasn't against God. He just wanted to be God. And because he couldn't hold that position, he assumed the position on the opposing side. So we all know what it's like to be in position but have to face opposition. I've gotten on some flights and people didn't think I was in the right position because of my skin. If I gave you the mic this morning, you might tell us that some folks on your job didn't think you were qualified for your position because you didn't have enough education or you didn't have enough experience. Watch this. The latest political uprising is over issues surrounding abortion in Mississippi. Or is that Alabama? Country. All right. Alabama. And so there are people who may argue with your position, but there are also, there are people who may agree with your position. Let me do it like that first. There are people who may agree with your position, and there are also some people who think your position is unjust and unbiblical and unconstitutional. Y'all ain't gonna say too much. When people don't like your position, you become a target for opposition. I need somebody to pray. When people don't understand your position, they may not respect your position. Over the last few months, I have learned how important it is to be in the right position spiritually and naturally. And I've also learned that when you stand fully in your position, opposition will arise to the occasion to distract, deter, and depress you. But perhaps the most important part of the lesson is that opposition is usually never directed at you. But opposition is directed at your position, because the enemy knows that your position is going to change. God intends to take you higher. God intends to move you to another level. God has positioned something in you that will bless you, but you won't be able to access it unless you get into position. I just came to encourage somebody who's frustrated in their position that it won't always be like this.
Spends the very first chapter of his book asking God, "Where are you
Habakkuk, they began to have a conversation. See, when you're in a relationship with God, God will talk to you. So the prophet would ask his questions, and God would give his answers. And so after a while, Habakkuk says, Habakkuk chapter 2, starting with the first verse, and I'm going to read it from the Common English Bible. It says, I will take my post. I will position myself on the fortress. I will keep watch to see what the Lord says to me and how he will respond to my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon a tablet so that a runner can read it. There is still a vision for the appointed time. It testifies to the end. It does not deceive. If it delays, in a place where I can see and hear you clearly. Habakkuk was willing to watch and wait. He was willing to stand still until God gave him the answers that he needed. Habakkuk questioned God, and watch this. When he was questioning God, he expected God to answer him. You will ask God some questions and expect God to answer. You won't get caught up in how long it takes because you know you're in relationship with God. And when you talk to God, God talks back. When you understand the importance of being in the right position, you will make up your mind to get into the right position and wait for God to answer you. See, the reality is that sometimes we ask God questions and we expect him to answer us. And we get frustrated when God doesn't answer according to our schedule. Y'all ain't gonna say that, no, anyway. We get mad if God doesn't do it in the time frame that we have provided God to move in. We lose faith when God doesn't move while we still feel like all things are going to work together for our good. If we don't learn how to stand on our watch, if we don't learn how to stay in position, God's answer will come and we will miss it. We'll never see it because we move out of position. We thought the answer wasn't coming, so we moved. We thought God was giving us a no, so we moved. And when the answer finally does come, when the blessing finally does come, we don't recognize it. We can't see it. We miss it because we're no longer in position. Even though Habakkuk was in a position where he had questions for God. Watch this. He's better than us. Because he had questions, but he still had a right attitude towards God. He said to God, I'm going to stand on my watch. I'm going to stay in position and see what God is going to say to me. I don't understand, God, what you're doing, but I know that you do everything well. I don't understand, God, why you're taking so long, but I know that you never made a mistake. I know that you never lost a battle. I know you've always had my back. I know you've never left me by myself. I know that when I didn't have the resources showed up just for me. I know that when I ran out, you sent somebody to bring me something else. I know, I know, I know, I know. But he took that foolishness to his father. The prophet was confronted with opposition, but he opened his mouth and talked to God. When you realize you can be in a bad place but still be in the right position, your whole life will change. You begin to see that God is God no matter where you are. God is able, even if you have inabilities. God is still God when you're sick. God is still God when it looks like the evil is prospering. God is still God when bad things happen to good people. We may not be able to see God's position, but our hearts have to be in the right position. Hearts have to be in the right position so that when we do catch a glimpse of God, we can move where he moves. So God tells Habakkuk to write down this little question and answer session that he's having with God. God said, write it down so that whoever reads it can run with it. They can run with the information. They can run with the word. They can run with the answers. They can take the message from one place to the next place. God said, write it down so they can run with it. Write it down so that there can be some progress. Not just any progress, but very quick progress. Sometimes a person can be in a position, but they don't really run with it. They have the information, they understand the assignment, but they don't run with it. When God has placed us in position, when God has given us a vision and we don't run with it, we are disobedient. And if you recall, scripture teaches us that folks who are disobedient end up taking the long way to get to a promised place. Folks who are disobedient end up in bondage. They end up locked out of blessing until their hearts are turned back toward God. Obedience births blessing. Obedience releases favor. Obedience releases favor. I'm stuck on favor.
They were trying to kill change. They were trying to kill
transformation. They were trying to stop the plan of God. But how many of you know in the house of God today that if God spoke it, he'll make it good? It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter how many roadblocks you put up. It doesn't matter how many stumbling blocks you make it over. If God says it, it's going to happen. I don't care how many laws you try to write in. I don't care how many bills you try to produce. If God says no, it ain't going to happen. So, time for the church to get into the right position. It's time for our leaders to get into the right position. It's time for us to stop standing and moving so slow, because it's time for us to run. It's time for us to stop allowing opposition to dictate how we flow in our position. Can y'all still see me? Am I just becoming visible? It's time for us to stop allowing opposition to shift us from our position. Here's the reality. Opposition should really teach you how to be steadfast and unmovable and always abounding in the work of the Lord. Opposition ought to teach you how to let this mind be in you that is also in Christ Jesus. Opposition shouldn't send you into a depression. Let me say that again. Opposition shouldn't send you into a depression. One more time for the Holy Ghost. Opposition shouldn't send you into a depression, but it should send you into a deeper place of prayer. And you should realize that your battle is not against flesh and blood, but your battle is against spirit. And once we learn that we're not fighting with people,
we never get into position, so we
feet to where I was going. Because I had a position. See, some of us think because we've been waiting so long that God has forgotten about us, that we're not going to get to the next place that we feel like God has promised us. But I need somebody to look down and check your boarding pass right now and see that as long as you are in relationship with Jesus, you already have your position secure. Can't nobody push you out of line. Can't nobody trade places with you to get in front of you. Tell you as long as you know that you know that you know that you know that God is able, you, nobody can take your position. You may not be there before some folk. You might get there after some folk. But the reality is, baby, you're going to get there. If you just stay in position. As long as you get in position. And as long as you run with the vision that God has given to you, nothing can keep you from your next level. Some of us have been in the same position so long, we think that's the only position. So we are right. We're just being right here. Ain't moved in 30 years. Because at least we can say we still here. We ain't done nothing, but we still.
Repent of your sins, and are in love and in charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees or at the altar of your heart.
Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may hereafter serve and please thee in the newness of life, to honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who thy great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all them with hearty repentance and true faith turn to thee, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all of our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord, Most High. Amen.
We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness. But in thy manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink of his blood, that our sinful souls and bodies may be made clean by his death and washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby the oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, most merciful Father. We most humbly beseech thee and grant that we, receiving these, thy creatures, of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. Oh, in the same night that Jesus was betrayed, he sat around a table with his friends. And on that table was some bread, regular bread. And he lifted the bread up to God, his Father, and he gave thanks. And then he looked and he said, friends, this bread tonight represents my body that will be broken for you. You're going to have some situations and some circumstances that occur where you're going to feel broken too. But because my body is broken for you, your brokenness is able to come back together in and through me. I make it all happen for you. So every time you eat this bread, I want you to remember that I'm the one who makes you whole. Let's eat together. Same night, at the same table, Jesus takes the wine. He lifts it up, he gives thanks to God, and then he says, friends, tonight, this wine represents my blood that's going to be poured out for you and for many. There will be times when you feel like you're powerless. There will be times when you feel like you can't make it. There will be times when you feel like you're so empty that you can't pour out that gift, that talent. You can't come up with that idea. But because my blood was poured out for you, you are now able to function at a level that you can't function in your own power. So every time you drink this wine, remember me. Let's drink together.